Hello and welcome to The Works. I'm Ben Peltier.
And I'm Ben Chee. Music can break down barriers between countries, cultures, and languages. Its benefits can include promoting healing, boosting memory, improving interpersonal coordination and thinking, and supporting emotional and sensory development. It's inclusive. It brings people together, including some of society's most disadvantaged. Later, members of the all-inclusive orchestra, True Color Symphony, will be here to tell us more.
But first, many welcomed the government's announcement last week of a relaxation of pandemic-related restrictions. Restaurants can welcome customers at night. Cinemas, museums, and performance venues can open again. So can art galleries. And as Art Basel Hong Kong and Art Central prepare for their upcoming events, many are hoping to get back to business as usual. There are even some new kids on the block.
The COVID-19 pandemic has been tough on many individuals and businesses, including those working in or involved with the arts. Art galleries have not escaped the privations. According to the Hong Kong Arts Gallery Association, over the past 2 years, and even more during the fifth wave of COVID-19, some commercial galleries have closed temporarily or moved to other spaces. The good news is that new ones have also opened. One of the new arrivals is this space in Causeway Bay. Sunsmith brings metalsmiths and other craftsmen together for workshops and programs that teach crafts techniques and local traditions. It is also a retail gallery that shows handmade jewelry and other objects.
When making the decision is somehow in the middle of pandemic, the fourth wave, and I think eventually the pandemic will be gone. We still have to live on. The reason why to establish my company is because I want the public to understand the true value of craftsmanship. Being a craftsman in Hong Kong is very, very difficult. And the rent in Hong Kong, the labor in Hong Kong is very costly. And we need to work very, very hard to balance ourselves. It's been a long time that people just like buying maybe European brands, Japanese fashion. So not many people would really think Made in Hong Kong is a nice brand. Personally, I don't agree with that. As long as if the team or the brand itself in Hong Kong, they put a lot of efforts and they know how to make quality products and how to promote it in the correct way, I think Made in Hong Kong should be something people are proud of.
Apart from promoting the work of local creators, Sunsmith provides workshops and programs, both introductory and more advanced, to give members of the public the chance to create their own pieces.
The one that I just demonstrated just now is actually making a sake cup. So that technique is focused on raising, a technique called raising. So what you do is you have like a sheet of metal first, and you slowly use the raising technique. So it kind of trains your patience a little bit. And then you raise it like its name. So you raise it slowly, bit by bit, and then layer by layer until it becomes a cup like this. Any type of metal you can learn here, like precious metal, like anything from copper, tin, silver, and also we have gold for the wedding bands as well. We actually have been running a few like teaware workshop, sakeware workshop, and also wedding ring workshops as well. So you can see there's quite a lot, a big variety, like different kinds of workshops. A lot of people who come don't have any backgrounds in goldsmithing, and that's totally normal. I would say just come with a joyful heart, be relaxed, and then we'll take care of the rest.
Over the past 2 months, when COVID-19 was as most virulent in Hong Kong, many art galleries either closed their doors or allowed viewings only by appointment. With the government gradually lifting COVID restrictions last week, others are back in business. Odds Ends has opened its door for the first time. It is set up by Fiona Holt and Natalie Ng, both of whom previously worked in Gallery HZ in Shenzhen. They say they want to promote local, regional, and even international emerging artists, including those working away from their home cultures.
I think we are here to have, like, provide a space for people to come and, you know, communicate. Having the gallery is important in turbulent times like now because people can come in, we can talk to them, they can share their whatever emotions, happiness, uncertainty, sadness. We can all talk about it.
Culturally speaking, I think it's a good time to do that because we have artists that have moved away and their way of expressing their emotions and what they have gone through, their experience through art, is very different when you translate it back to Hong Kong versus when you, you know, do it locally. That's why I think it's very important to introduce that narrative, a different narrative of your shared experience in an art form.
The gallery's debut exhibition, currently on show, is Something Blue. It features works by three Hong Kong artists, Peter Chan, Coin Ho, and Louis Lau.
These three artists might not necessarily use predominantly the color blue, but they convey a sense of nostalgia. They explore themes of the human psyche, a very conceptual and abstract ideas that are channeled usually through cooler tones in art. As opposed to warmer tones, people, it usually conveys a sense of passion, emotion, feelings. Whereas blue is more psychologically intriguing as a color in art.
I really have been in the gallery business for more than 10 years. And I've seen how Hong Kong has changed over these years. Being able to witness this whole thing is very precious for me because this is like my home, and I wish to be able to continue showing local talents, but also like bring in Asian artists or Hong Kong artists who have moved abroad or like live in overseas to be able to show their talents in the Hong Kong market. We want to do art fairs in overseas.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we're because a lot of our artists are, they have a practice outside of Hong Kong. It would be interesting to see how their work translates in other culture and other countries. The only thing I would say back to the challenge issue is logistically, we have had some issues with shipping, but that would all ease up soon once we kind of settle into this post-pandemic era.
Hong Kong changes fast. That can be a good thing, but one side effect is that we can quickly lose connections with our past and forget the way Hong Kong people and the place used to look. Photographers, both those based here and those passing through, help to preserve that past. On show at the Asia Society's Hong Kong Center until early June are 87 photographs of Hong Kong from the 1940s to the 1970s through the eyes of three such photographers.
German photographer Hedda Morrison arrived in 1946 and stayed for 6 months. She photographed Hong Kong's people and its streets. New Zealand-born Brian Brake came in 1957 and lived here on and off up to the mid-1970s. Singaporean sailor Lee Fook Chee arrived in 1947, worked as a photographer for many years, and remained here until his death in 2012.
Thank you.
Welcome back. The PMA Music Foundation, or PMF, was set up in 2003 to promote inclusivity and to enable musicians and other inspirational figures to work with those often sidelined by society. In 2019, the organization founded True Colors Symphony, an inclusive orchestra to develop and highlight the musical talents of the differently abled and those from different demographic groups and ethnicities. The symphony also has 66 choir members. In 2020, they gave their inaugural performance at the Hong Kong Cultural Center. Project manager Mandy Lee and erhu player Young En Hua are here to tell us more.
Okay, Mandy Lee, Ethan Yang, welcome to The Works. Mandy, we'll start with you. So the True Color Symphony consists of many different groups. There are different age groups, different ethnic groups, different differently abled groups as well. Maybe perhaps you can tell us, go into more detail. Tell us about the different types of people in the orchestra.
Okay, and as of today, we have over 200 members in our orchestra. And our members include the children, teenager, although and the ethnic minority and the visually impaired, hearing impaired, physical impaired, and the student with autism spectrum disorder or other special educational need. And our most senior member is around 70 years old, and the youngest one is around 9 years old.
Wow.
Yes, so that is a big difference.
It's a big range, and
yes.
It sounds like it's a very inclusive orchestra. So if people wanted to actually join the orchestra, how do they do that?
Actually, we have many programs running in TCS. And if you want to be our members, you could apply for the Chukas Chamber Groups or Chukas Choir. And music background is expected, and you need to take the audition before joining us. And if you don't have any instrumentation background, you could choose to join the choir and sing with us.
Right.
And moreover, we need a lot of volunteers. And you could just sign up in our website and we will contact for the arrangement.
Right. I can imagine, you know, being an inclusive orchestra with such a diverse range of people, there must be many challenges and difficulties running or working with the orchestra. Can you tell us what are some of those challenges and how you overcome them?
The most challenging is the we need to get the balance between the musical ability of our members. For example, we need to choose some easier pieces or rearrange the music for them so that they could all play together in the orchestra.
Right.
Yes.
All right, I'm going to turn to you, Ethan Yang. You started learning the erhu at the age of 12 as a visually impaired learner. Tell me about the challenges for you learning the erhu and how you overcame them.
Yeah, I am visually impaired. And my vision continues to decline. I think that the biggest challenge for visually impaired people learning an instrument is reading the sheet music. When I was 12 years old, I only had 10% of the eyesight of a normal person. Therefore, I could see an enlarged version of the sheet music. At this time, the teacher used the brush to copy the score for me, and one piece of paper can only hold a score of a dozen bars.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I think it takes me at least maybe 9 months to learn a complete piece of music.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Later, in 2017, my vision was less than 5%. I couldn't see the sheet music anymore. My teacher sang the score for me, like.
Right.
Do, do, so, la, la, so, it's this.
Wow.
Yeah, I recorded it and and practice it over and over again. I think this is one. Moreover, when I collaborate with the True Colors Symphony, I not only have to memorize the score, but also overcome the difficulties of I cannot see the director.
Yeah.
Finally, I find a way to master the timing of playing phrases by listening to the conductor's breathing. Like this, yeah. I know the next bar I can play the
album. Amazing.
Yeah, and in all, I think require more effort for visually impaired people to learn music. Yeah.
So, Ethan, I know you're going to perform something on the Erhu for us today. Tell us the name of this piece and what the song is about.
Okay. I will play an Erhu piece, Horse Racing for Everyone. This is a work created on the theme of Mongolian folk songs. The piece describes the lively scene of Mongolian racing horses on the grassland. A colorful part in the middle of music describes the vast landscape of the grassland. I hope you all enjoy it.
Looking forward to hearing it. And thank you both of you for coming in.
Thank you.
Thank you.